Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Monday here at the Northeast Georgia History Center in the Cottrell Digital Studio. We're very pleased to be bringing you a special three-part series on Indian removal in Georgia and in the Southeast. Specifically, we're going to be looking at the Cherokee, the Choctaw, and the approaches of the United States and the state of Georgia in this very crucial time. Now, this is incredibly relevant to us as Georgians. This is incredibly relevant to us as Americans because this forms an important part of our past and the way that we progressed from really independence immediately following the Revolution all the way up to the present day. And this three-part series is going to look at three remarkable men who played a rather significant role in Indian removal in the 1830s. The first that we're going to see today is Cherokee Principal Chief John Ross. Tomorrow we're going to meet Greenwood LaFleur, a leader of the Choctaw. And then Wednesday we're going to meet President of the United States, Andrew Jackson, and hear some of his thoughts on what exactly Indian removal meant, how the United States had gotten to that point, and what it was going to mean not only for the future of the United States, but for the future of these Native American tribes as well. So today's episode, I think we need to go back just a little bit and sort of set up a context for everything. And from the very first time Europeans set foot on the shores of America, one of the biggest things they were concerned with and one of the things that brought them here was land. There was a huge continent available to them that was one of the things that brought them over, the opportunity to have their own piece of land, their own farm, something that would give them an independence. But of course, the trick is that there were already people living here who we call the Native Americans and the different tribes. Now, over the course of a couple of centuries from the very first European contact in the 1500s and 1600s, disease had spread amongst the Native Americans and had actually killed a great number of them. We had talked previously about some of the spread of disease in North America and how that had brought a lot of these civilizations crumbling down and how as much as 90% of the Native population had died. Of course, this is going to have a huge impact on how these Native Americans are able to function, on how they're able to rebuild their cultures, their societies, and how they're going to interact with the Europeans. Now, I also have to let you know that this three-part series focuses on, as I said, Georgia and North Georgia and some of the stories of the Southeast, but this is a huge story and will really only be scratching the surface. So I encourage you to go and do some further reading on this very interesting, very relevant topic. Now, for our purposes today, we need to talk about the different Indian tribes that were still living east of the Mississippi in the Southeast specifically. The Cherokee, the Creeks, the Choctaw, the Chickasaw, the Seminoles, all these are tribes that were considered numerous enough to have relations with the federal government. And the United States Constitution says that only the federal government has the power to treat with the various Native nations because they are considered sovereign. A lot of argument then comes out about exactly what sovereignty means. There are court cases that go all the way up to the Supreme Court that sort of wrestle with these issues. What does it mean to be sovereign? Who can deal with Native American tribes? Who has the right to interact with them and to set laws in favor of or against them? Is it only the federal government? Do the states also have rights in terms of how they interact with Native Americans and how they can limit others interacting with these Native American tribes, especially the Cherokee? So today we're going to focus on the Cherokee. By the 1820s, the Cherokee had actually undergone what has been called the Cherokee Renaissance. They had made every effort to assimilate into European and American white culture. They had adopted subsistence farming, with the men doing most of the farming work rather than the women, as had traditionally been done. They had developed a written language. They had their own newspaper. They had a written constitution that enshrined their form of government with an executive, a judicial, and a legislative branch. And so they were very advanced. They had even joined as allies with the United States to fight against other Native American tribes. There were a variety of reasons that they would do this, but a couple of the important ones to remember are, of course, access to land, insurance of sovereignty, and the idea that they can show the United States that they are not only sovereign, but a valuable and integral part of the continuance of the United States as it goes forward into history. So the Cherokees, to use a simplified term, they had done everything right. They had gone as far as they could. And yet that still wasn't enough. There was still a drive to take these lands that were still east of the Mississippi and distribute them to the states that they were in for further settlement by mostly white Americans. And the biggest step that happened was the Indian Removal Act of 1830. And this is something that went through Congress that Andrew Jackson supported. He had become president in 1828. And with his supporters in Congress and him signing this legislation into effect means that it was now incumbent upon the executive to arrange for removal. The Indian Removal Act did not come out and say all Indians must be removed, although that was implied. What it did is it gave power to the president and his administration to begin negotiations with these varying tribes to move everything they have and settle in lands west of the Mississippi, generally in what is now Oklahoma, which was then considered Indian country. So John Ross has been elected as principal chief of the Cherokee, and there's probably no other person who's better to take this role than John Ross. He, as you could say, has a foot in both worlds. He is raised Cherokee, but he also has been educated. He speaks, he writes English, he's a merchant, he's very successful financially, he's a plantation owner. He has basically taken on all the aspects of an upper-class white American, but he is also a Cherokee, and he leads his people in tribal councils on the executive branch, and also interacts with the legislature as well. And he is very much part of the resistance against these efforts to remove the Cherokee to the west, and we'll learn more about his perspective on that in just a minute. There are other people. There's the Treaty Party, amongst them Major Ridge and his son, who begin to negotiate with the United States government. Their feeling, again, I'm summing up a little bit here, but in a nutshell, they believe that the forces of history are overwhelming, that there's very little they can do to hold back the forces that will remove the Cherokee to the west, away from their ancestral homes. So they decide to get as good a deal as they can while they can. They begin to negotiate with Jackson's administration, and in 1836, they signed the Treaty of New Echota. Now, the Treaty of New Echota was signed by a great number of representatives of the Cherokee government, but it didn't necessarily reflect the majority of people's will amongst the regular citizenry of the Cherokee. But of course, the United States passes, or I should say they ratify this treaty. The treaty stipulates a couple of different things, that the nation will receive $5 million in pay in exchange for their lands. They will have their expenses paid to move from the Cherokee national lands in the east to the west, that they will be given an equal number of lands, equal acreage of land in the west compared to what they have in the east. Ross really tries to oppose not only the treaty negotiations, he tries to have the treaty changed after it's signed by the Cherokee and ratified by the U.S. Senate. And for the next 2 years, he does everything in his power to try to hold off these forces. But of course, in the end, he's not able to do this. Whether it's the forces of history, whether it's Andrew Jackson, whether it's the state of Georgia, lots of things come together to prevent him from being able to stop the effects of the Treaty of New Echota from taking place and pushing the Cherokee to the west. Now, let's go ahead and hear what John Ross has to say about these very complex issues.
In the year 1835, three events convinced me that the resistance movement I led in the Cherokee Nation to oppose signing a treaty with the United States to remove us to lands west of the Mississippi were doomed. First, in that year, my home was auctioned away from me illegally by the state of Georgia while I was away negotiating in Washington, D.C., with me finding out by returning to find someone else living there. Second, the Cherokee Nation's printing press was seized by the Georgia Guard to intentionally prevent the exercise of free speech against removal. And third, I was kidnapped by the Georgia Guard and held for several days, with the governor denying knowledge to keep me from speaking against removal as the Cherokee began debating signing a treaty. These events showed, in fine, the larger picture of my people's situation on the eve of our removal. Despite the Supreme Court of the United States in Cherokee versus Georgia and Worcester versus Georgia affirming Cherokee sovereignty, with Georgia and its militia having no legal jurisdiction over the nation. The disregard for property and boundaries by the state of Georgia in 1835 demonstrated that legal mechanisms would increasingly become powerless to help us. My kidnapping and the seizure of our press put the voice of opposition out of contact and circulation, even as a time was being set for negotiations in December of 1835 with the nation for a final decision on removal, which a faction approved in the Treaty of New Echota. All of these events, carrying larger currents in them, became a confluence, which presented me with but two stark choices: to see my people sacrificed in a futile defense of our rights, or admit defeat. I tried to do both throughout 1836, 1837, and 1838, even as some of the people removed on their own with the treaty party. But it was weeks after the date for enforced removal was to begin in 1839 that I finally returned to my people with the federal agreement for the nation to oversee their own removal journey. Though U.S. Army regulars had rounded up the Cherokee into camps of emigration where they awaited the great trek, it would be the nation itself which oversaw the journey, even down to hiring the contractors, such as my own brother, Edward Ross, to arrange food, transportation, and lodging as I led along the way. Due to the lateness of the year in starting the journey, and most of it being during the winter, many of the nation died on the trail. The treaty party, which had not experienced deaths on their travel, would perhaps lay those deaths at mine and my brother's feet for delaying the journey to the wrong time of the year and being ill-prepared. But it was the Treaty of New Echota, forced on us by the Indian Removal Act, that caused our journey across the Mississippi to a new frontier. A new frontier. My people have ever been of the frontier, whether that be the Anyuwinya, the Cherokee, the principal people, or the Alba folk, the Scottish people. My heritage is that of two warlike races, renowned for their poetic spirit, martial prowess, and for prospering in beautiful and wild lands. My Cherokee and Scottish ancestors have always fought for and defended fiercely our territories. From the ancient times, my Scottish fathers and mothers fought the English domination of their land, and generations ago, many came into these mountains, and some of their numbers commingled with the Cherokee. So similar to them in the love for their freedom and the land. So I, John Ross, descendant of the noble Cherokee Nation and the proud Scott Nation, principal chief of the Cherokee, ventured past a frontier unlike any my ancestors have had to explore. This was the result of the Treaty of New Echota, signed by 22 of my fellow Cherokee National Council members, including the great Major Ridge and his son John Ridge, and other leaders such as Elias Budnat, Teskeski, Tegahiski, Robert Rogers, Stan Waite, even my brother Andrew Ross, but not signed by me. They represented many of the nation, but not the majority of the nation. There are many who view the signers as violating Cherokee law by exchanging the nation's land, and thus subject to summary execution by any member of the nation. Major Ridge, John Ridge, Elias Budnat, and others were executed. There are those in the nation who say I approved of their deaths beforehand. Regardless, the plain fact is that these new lands are now our nation's only chance to survive as a people. Whether one approved the Treaty of New Echota, as the late Ridges did, or sought to continue negotiations as I did, treaty party or national party, these factions may be called. Both factions are Cherokee and of the nation. Both wish for peace and prosperity. We shall see.
All right, as you can see, Principal Chief John Ross was in a very tough spot. You have the forces of history and this overwhelming desire by the United States government and by the state of Georgia to take this land, and yet you have the will of the Cherokee people who do not want to leave. This is where they have lived for generations and generations. And this is, if you take nothing else, from this entire series that we'll have today and over the next 3 days, I want you to remember the complexities of the issues and how there's so many things, so many different things at play that it's difficult to wrap your head around these things all at once. Now, let me go ahead and let you know that we're going to be taking questions and answering those questions as best we can. So if you have questions, go ahead and be thinking about those and go ahead and be typing those in, and we'll get to those as we go through the program. But let me sort of talk about what Ross's perspective was on a lot of these things. As Ross pointed out, he wanted to take control of removal and make it something the Cherokee did themselves rather than leaving it in the hands of the federal government. Now, this had some ramifications because none of the Cherokee had any experience in moving this many people this far. There were supply issues, timing issues, transportation issues. Where are you going to get the horses and the wagons and things like that? You can't take all the supplies for the entire journey with you. You're going to have stations set up along the way with supplies so that you'll have plenty of clothing, plenty of food for the horses. And the mules are going to be pulling these wagons and carrying the supplies and carrying the people. It's a very complex move, and the Cherokee were not ready for it. You heard Ross say that his brother was given the contract to supply this so that it could be in the hands of a Cherokee rather than in the hands of the federal government. Well, this is nothing bad to say about his brother, but his brother had zero experience about this kind of operation. And so he was not prepared for the complexities and the size of it. And so a lot of the shortage of supplies along the way were because of this. If they had left it in the hands of the Army is used to, as I said, moving this many people this far, perhaps the Army would have been able to do a better job of it. They left late in the year. Again, this was efforts by Ross to try to maintain control of the Cherokees' own destiny and let them be the ones to determine the move. Well, they're not ready. They don't have the supplies ready. Ross is continuing to try to negotiate and try to negate some of the terms of the Treaty of New Echota, which puts moving later and later in the year. Originally, the way that the treaty was set up and the way the Army had things organized, they were going to leave in the summer months. They were going to leave around June or July. Because of Ross's efforts to try to put this off and to try to change things, it gets pushed and it gets pushed so that they do not leave until the worst time of the year to travel. And as a matter of fact, here on the History Center campus, we have a cabin that belonged to White Path, who was a leader amongst the Cherokee. He was removed during the Trail of Tears. He was someone who died on the way. He made the journey all the way from what is now Ellijay, if you know where that's at, in North Georgia. And he traveled up until Hopkinsville, Kentucky, and there he died. He was an old man, and the journey proved to be too much for him. And he is buried there today in Hopkinsville, Kentucky. And there's a memorial park there for a couple of the different Cherokee who are buried there with him. So Ross, while trying to do the right thing for his people, logistically made a pretty bad decision in terms of who was going to move, how they were going to get there, what time of year they were going to get there. So this is just one example that I sort of want to share with you so you can understand how complex these things can be. Let me go ahead and take some of these questions. So Doodlebug wants to know if his brother was executed. I don't think Ross's brother was executed. The main three of the treaty party, Major Ridge, his son John Ridge, and Elias Boudinot, who had been the editor of the Cherokee Phoenix, the Cherokee newspaper, they were in fact assassinated. And this was something that was planned by a group of people because they were all killed on the exact same night. So this was something that was planned. This was something that was organized once everyone had gotten to Oklahoma and they were killed. But I don't believe that Ross's brother were killed. RDG Random asked, how many people died on the trail? And this is a really tough question to answer. There is no question that a lot of people died on the Trail of Tears. And I want to come back to that term, Trail of Tears, in just a moment. But the numbers that we have vary greatly. Some of the early accounts said that as many to a third to a half of the Cherokee who left during this time died on the trail. That's probably a good bit of an exaggeration because the records are so spotty. They took a roll call at the beginning of the trip, and they took a roll call at the end. And basically the way you can get some of those numbers is just to subtract one from the other. Well, a lot of people left along the way. A lot of people decided not to go and to hide up in the woods. And long story short, in North Carolina, Western North Carolina, what becomes the Eastern Band of the Cherokee today. A lot of the record keeping is spotty, so we don't really know. It's the most conservative numbers say anywhere from 1,000 to 1,500, which is still about a tenth to an eighth of the numbers who were set to be moved to Oklahoma. And a lot of that is because of the shortage of supplies, the shortage of proper clothing and proper protective gear for the weather that was going to be going on at the time. But again, these are really, you know, whose fault is it? I think don't get into that argument for this specific part of it. You have to look at how things progressed. It could be Ross's brother's fault for not supplying things. It could be the Army's fault for letting them take it over. It could be all of our faults for having let it happen in the first place. But the bottom line is we don't really know how many people died. We don't know how many people died directly as a result of issues along the trail. So I guess, RDG, the answer is we don't really know. But it was a significant enough number that shouldn't have happened. And Raphael Mika asked, did some Cherokees stay in Georgia? That's also a great question. As originally negotiated, the Treaty of New Echota allowed anyone who wanted to renounce their Cherokee citizenship and remain in Georgia as a citizen of the state of Georgia and of the United States, they could choose to do so. And they would still receive, they would still be able to hold on to their lands. They would still be able to vote in state and national elections and things like that. The problem is, Andrew Jackson himself struck through that part of the treaty and disallowed it. So not a lot of Cherokees stayed in Georgia. A lot of those that did not want to go, that wanted to at least remain in the East, did avoid concentration, and they did sort of, quote unquote, escape to the hills. And they lived there for a few generations until they were able to consolidate and get recognition by the federal government. And as I said, that's the origins, really, of the Eastern Band of the Cherokee. A lot of you may have actually visited Cherokee, North Carolina. That's the home that they made for themselves when they were able to sort of escape the removal and remain in their homes. Let's see. Oh, Melon LaGrange has a great question. Did the Cherokee try to fight back with force? Not really. They did not. And as to why that is, I have a couple of anecdotes. I'm not sure I can necessarily pin this and say, here is why, because each individual has to make those choices for themselves as to whether to participate in armed resistance or to try to go along. A couple of aspects of this. The Cherokee, as I said earlier, they sort of played the game. They tried to assimilate, and they tried to fight removal through legal, political means, and they never really did rise up and act violently to oppose it. And even when they were being rounded up, even on the trail itself, there are isolated examples of violence, but there's nothing remotely approaching sort of a concerted effort to violently and physically resist. I think, and this is just me talking right now, but I think a big reason for that is that everyone knew they would lose. Everyone knew that armed resistance would probably turn out to be a worse outcome than if they simply went, because it was still within some living memory when the Cherokee had sided with the British against the Americans during the American Revolution. And when that happened, there were militia, there were groups of men who joined together from Georgia, South Carolina, and North Carolina and went into the Cherokee country. They burned crops, they burned villages, they killed a lot of people, and basically the Cherokee remembered that when you try to fight against this violently, that the response from the Americans is going to be overwhelming. It is going to be overwhelming, and they remember this. It was only about a generation to a generation and a half removed from the events of the 1830s. So I think they all more or less officially agreed that violent resistance was simply not going to work. Let's see. Mackenzie wants to know what year this is. So the Treaty of New Echota is signed in 1836. It allows 2 years for the Cherokee to get their affairs in order and move to the West. And about 25 to 30% of the Cherokee go ahead and move in that two-year time frame. They go ahead, they go out there. There's no significant mass death or anything like that. They sort of go in small groups and as families. By 1838, when it's time for everyone to have left, this is when the U.S. Army begins going and gathering people into groups at some of the removal forts and starts sending them on their way in groups. This is really spring of 1838. And so the passage from the east to the west takes place over the fall and winter of 1838 to 1839. And by summer of 1839, pretty much all the Cherokee who are going to go to Oklahoma have gone there. So that's sort of the time frame we're talking about for the actual act of Cherokee removal. Eden, who's only 10 years old, thank you for watching, Eden, wants to know if they walked the whole way or did they use another form of transportation? So this varied. All the Cherokee were allowed to take their portable personal property with them. Of course, they couldn't take their barns or their houses or anything like that, but if they had horses, if they had wagons, if they had carts, they would be able to take it. And I think really it sort of varied upon each family's condition. If they had enough things that needed to be carried in a cart or a wagon, they might walk alongside of it. If there was room in the cart or a wagon for some of the younger or some of the older folks, they might ride in the wagon. Now, this may sound sort of cruel to us, but you have to remember This is in a 3 mile per hour world. People are very used to walking. Most places, riding a horse, riding a mule, or riding in a wagon is something people did, but those animals, as often as not, were used for transporting stuff rather than transporting people. So a lot of them probably did walk along together, along with their collected items, but that was very common regardless. That was just a common way to get around. Kendra Coker asked, how many Indian tribes are located in this area of Georgia? Where the Northeast Georgia History Center is, sort of in the northeast of the state, really we're only talking about the Cherokee from around 1750s until removal in 1838. There had been other tribes in this area. Some of the Creek, we believe, had lived in this area, but they had also gotten pushed out and removed by the Cherokee coming down from the north and sort of from the northeast, had pushed the Creeks back into what's now Alabama, South Georgia, and Mississippi. The Cherokee were doing this because they were being pushed by European settlement along the coast. So it's just sort of a pushing effect where once the settlements from Europe start on the East Coast, everyone starts getting pushed and pushed, and displacements start to happen that way. RDG Random also wants to know, why did they kidnap John Ross? That's a good question. And let me say, from a big overall picture, a lot of the issues that lead to removal aren't so much between the Cherokee and the federal government. They're between the Cherokee and the state of Georgia, right? So the governors of Georgia are trying to get the land that the Cherokee are on, because the Cherokee land is about anywhere, depending on how you count it, about a fifth to a sixth of the state acreage at this point. So they want to get that property. Georgia passes a lot of laws that negate Cherokee sovereignty. They pass laws that forbid the Cherokee from having any sort of government within the boundaries of the state of Georgia. Lots of things like that. They violate Cherokee sovereignty by sending the Georgia Guard, sort of a posse of men who have law enforcement responsibilities given by the governor, going into the Cherokee territory. So they kidnap, from a reality perspective, they sort of kidnap John Ross. From their perspective, they have arrested him for violating some of the laws of the state of Georgia, but they realize they're not going to be able to hold the principal chief of the Cherokee in what used to be his house in Cherokee territory without getting a lot of trouble from the federal government and from the Cherokee themselves. That's why he's only kidnapped for a few days. But this is the sort, it's not just John Ross, this is the sort of thing that goes on throughout the Cherokee territory during this time. As a matter of fact, one of the really most interesting aspects of this that start to define how Georgia is attacking Cherokee sovereignty happens right here in Gainesville. There's a trial here in Gainesville from a fellow named Corntassel. Corntassel, it seems, had committed murder in the Cherokee country by murdering another Cherokee. He was a Cherokee person. He killed another Cherokee person. It doesn't seem that anyone's arguing whether or not he killed the person. It's a question of who's in charge of bringing him to justice. The Cherokee say, obviously it's the Cherokee because he killed a Cherokee in Cherokee territory. This is our say. The Georgians say, no, no, Georgia's in charge here. They send the Georgia Guard into Cherokee territory, capture him, and bring him back to Gainesville, and he stands trial. He's found guilty, and his case gets sent up to the Supreme Court. And before the Supreme Court can really decide on it, the governor of the state of Georgia orders him executed, and he is hanged here in Gainesville, making, as the Supreme Court says, it's without merit. The case has no merit because the person who is a subject of the case is now dead. So that court case right here in Gainesville sort of starts the ball rolling when it comes to efforts by the Cherokee to argue their sovereignty from a legal perspective in the Supreme Court. Let's see, Melanie LaGrange, what sicknesses killed most of the natives? There's a lot of different sicknesses and diseases that play into this. Europeans, having gone through a couple of centuries of the Black Plague and the Black Death and the bubonic plague and smallpox and things like that, have built up much stronger immunities to these diseases, but they're still carriers. And when they bring them to the New World, the Native Americans have zero resistance to them. So a lot of what you see is smallpox especially, typhus, cholera, and these are things that still affect Europeans. Europeans and Americans can still die when they catch smallpox, but the native populations are much more susceptible to it. And so these diseases start to have massive effects on just the pure numbers of the native populations, which makes it harder for them to exert influences and assert their own sovereignty when their numbers continue to decrease. Oh, Bonnie wants to know, how did the Cherokee adjust to life in Oklahoma, and were there any difficulties with tribes already living there? Imagine being told that where you live now, you can't live there anymore, and you're going to be picked up and plopped somewhere else. So the homes of yourself and your family and your ancestors, where you had grown up for generations, you don't live there anymore. So of course there's going to be a massive amount of emotional stress and heartbreak that comes from this. A lot of the land that the Cherokee received in Oklahoma was not the best land in terms of farming and in terms of viability for agriculture, but they didn't really have a great deal of conflict with other Native American tribes in Oklahoma. But before I get too much into that, I want to let you know that tomorrow's broadcast sort of addresses a different Indian perspective of the Choctaw and how they dealt with going to Oklahoma and what happened when they got there. So if you will sort of keep that question in mind, and after tomorrow's broadcast or at the end of tomorrow's broadcast, we can readdress that, because it does play into a lot of different things. Let's see. Evelyn wants to know, in the background, is that Ross's house? Yes, indeed it is. You may have seen the image in our video that showed a black and white photo, a very early photo of Ross's house. The image that you see behind me is actually a modern picture of Ross's house. You can see that it is a log cabin, actually. It's a two-story log cabin. It's pretty big, too, because, again, Ross was a pretty well-to-do person. He was very successful financially. He had married very well. He was the principal chief of the entire Cherokee Nation, so he was doing very well for himself. And this is the sort of home that in the Cherokee country would have been considered a very, very nice place. So yes, that's a good idea, or that's a good observation that is his house. Let's see. Oh, Doodlebug wants to know, did they quarantine the sick people? You know, honestly, I don't know the answer to that. I don't know if they would have or not. Because, you know, a lot of times, a lot of the deaths start out just being a factor of poor nutrition and exposure on the Trail of Tears. And so I honestly don't know if they began to quarantine people who appeared to be sick on the trail or not. But I had said also that I would address Trail of Tears. And this is something, and you'll see in our broadcast tomorrow, where the origin of that name, the Trail of Tears, comes from. And at the time, this wasn't necessarily something the Native Americans universally used to refer to them having to relocate involuntarily from one place to the other. This is something that we've come to address it as. And it's been generally associated with the Cherokee, but as you'll see in our next couple of broadcasts, the story of Indian removal from the East is something that is almost universal amongst the Native American tribes that were still there in the 1820s and the 1830s. Let's see. Mackenzie wants to know if John Ross is the oldest or youngest of the siblings.
Looks like he's second oldest.
Okay, yeah, thank you, Libba, because I don't have that information in my head, Mackenzie, but it looks like he was the second oldest. So he was not the oldest, but I think all of his brothers, he and all of his brothers were sent east, I think to Connecticut, to a school, and they learned English, they learned mathematics, they learned literature. It's very interesting. Here's an interesting thing about John Ross. He's principal chief of the Cherokee, right? He is their leader. In effect, he's their president of their country. John Ross could not speak Cherokee. He could not speak the native tongue because he had been involved so much in European and American culture. That's how he had been educated. The Scots part of his family, as you saw from the video, was a very important part of what he considered his background and his culture. Like I said, he sort of has a foot in each world, and he tends to lean one way or the other on each foot, depending upon what he needs to do, not only for himself, but for the benefit of the Cherokee. So, on the other hand, here is Major Ridge, who was part of the Treaty Party, who was one of the leaders trying to make the Treaty of New Echota work. He was a full-blooded Cherokee. Full-blooded, that means both of his parents were 100% Cherokee. He could not speak English. He could only speak Cherokee. And it's one of those great ironies. So here you have the full-blooded Cherokee who can't speak English trying to work things out for his people to be removed and being in favor of the Treaty of New Echota. And here you have someone who is only 1/8 Cherokee, who can't even speak the language, who is working for the benefit of the Cherokee people to resist the Treaty of New Echota. So as you can see, this is a very complicated thing, and it's not just about Andrew Jackson, it's not about the federal government, it's not about the state of Georgia, but one of the most interesting aspects when you're looking at removal, and really some of the most heartrending, is how this question split the Cherokee themselves. And there were different family members. Again, John Ross's brother signed the treaty, right? So it's breaking apart families, it's breaking apart communities, it's breaking apart the entire nation. This question of what are we going to do? How are we going to address this remarkably dangerous and unprecedented situation that we face? So it's sad, but it's also fascinating.
So I think our last question, maybe?
Okay, yeah, we'll do one more question.
We have, maybe you can talk about the time that John Ross lived in the home behind, which is 1830 to 1838.
Right, so Ross lived in this house from 1830 to 1838 until removal. Even though, like I said, it was sort of taken from him. You saw it in the video from Ross that when he arrived back home, they had already given his house and his land to someone else. They eventually made those people leave and got back together. The Indian Removal Act is put through Congress and signed into law in 1830. All right. Treaty of New Echota is signed 1836. The Cherokee are one of the last tribes to actually come to a negotiated treaty with the federal government. Other Native American tribes had gotten theirs out of the way. You'll see more about that tomorrow. But during this time, there's a lot of flux within the Cherokee Nation, and they're not exactly sure what they're going to do and what's going on. So John Ross, while this is where he lives, he is also going back and forth and back and forth to Washington, D.C. Now, he can't jump on a train, he can't get on an airplane, he can't even get in a car and drive down the road. That means he has to walk or ride a horse from northwest Georgia all the way up to Virginia, to the very end of Virginia and going into Maryland, right? This journey can take several weeks just to get there. So he gets together the information he can, gets on his horse or gets in a carriage, spends 6 weeks going to Washington, D.C., stays there, tries to negotiate, tries to agitate for his people's rights, gets what he can, and then has to turn around and come back weeks and weeks at a time, gets back into the Cherokee country, and begins to talk to his people and tell them the news that he's found, tell them the things that he's been trying to do on their behalf. Tries to work some other things out, then has to go back to Washington. So John Ross is actually away from home probably more than he's there because the travel time takes so long. He doesn't have the benefit that we have now with technology and the internet where communication can be instantaneous. Even writing letters, a letter is still going to take 2 to 3 weeks to get from Georgia all the way up to Washington, D.C., and then you have to give the time to have the response. So, the material conditions of the world in which they live sort of slowed things down and made things happen at a pace that they couldn't necessarily address politically or socially or from a point of information. So, with that being said, I hope this encourages you to go do some reading about John Ross, about Indian removal. But don't forget, we have 2 more days in this series. Tomorrow we'll be meeting with Greenwood LaFleur from the Choctaw tribe. And the day after that, we'll be hearing from Andrew Jackson, 7th President of the United States. So tune in over the next 2 days especially to continue this series. Thank you for tuning in to the Northeast Georgia History Center. This is a very trying time, but we're so glad that we have you here with us. We're so honored that you're able to invite us into your home and let us share some of these great stories of our past with you. If you appreciate what we do, please consider making a donation. You can go to our website and click on the donate button, and every little bit helps. But you don't have to, but it helps. So thanks again, everyone, and we will see you tomorrow at the Northeast Georgia History Center.